Hey guys, Mark D'Amato here.
And I dropped the fucking needles. This is the start of the record.
And welcome back to Mindbreakers. I'm just going to bring up our little wheel.
Yes.
Bam. Going to give it a spin. Spin. Thank you.
Oh my god, what is this, baby?
Maniac Cop 2.
Oh my god, I watched this over the weekend.
Did you watch this or the...
I watched the first one, Maniac Cop 1.
Perfect.
During the weekend. Oh god, we're gonna watch the sequel?
Yeah.
Shit. That was a crazy fucking movie, the first one. Like, my god, it had people just getting their straight up, like, their fucking... throat slit by a fucking guy dressed as a cop.
A supernatural maniac killer cop teams up with a Times Square serial killer.
What?
Yes. Matt Cordell's back, ladies and gentlemen.
He has friends.
He's back and he's got friends.
He's got a friend.
Let's watch this shit.
Officer Cordell is dead. People are safe to walk the streets again. Or are they?
Must be visiting hours! Because my friend is back!
The nightmare has returned.
Who's a great big cop? 6'3", maybe more.
Shooting Cordell's only good for getting his attention.
So Mallory's dead because she knew the truth.
What's the matter, Commissioner? You finally believe in ghosts?
He's still alive.
Maniac Cop 2. Robert Davi, License to Kill. Claudia Christian, The Hidden. Michael Lerner, The Postman Always Rings Twice. Bruce Campbell, The Evil Dead. And Leo Rossi, The Accused. Star in Maniac Cop 2.
Okay, guys, for starters... this movie ends with a rap.
It does?
It ends with the Maniac 2 rap.
Oh, right.
Maniac Cop rap. And it's actually pretty good.
Well, it's better than another movie we saw that ended with a rap back in October.
Yeah.
Cool school. Wow.
So it's better than a lot of movies that end with raps. Actually, you know what? All movies that end with raps are the best movies.
Well, yeah, Monster Squad.
Monster Squad.
Monster Squad is amazing.
But, yeah, so I watched the first one of this, and now I've seen the second one.
And for those who actually watch continuously this
the series,
Nelson and I covered Maniac Cop 1.
Yeah, I ended up watching it anyways. And whoever covers the third one, like, honestly, I'm still going to watch it regardless.
I don't know why, but I'm 80% sure it's going to end up being Matt, because the universe seems to hate Matt and give him the worst movies.
God, yes. So the movie starts off basically with the ending in progress of the first one.
Mm.
What's her name again?
Ross? No.
Man.
Mallory.
Mallory, yeah.
Lieutenant Mallory has a shotgun. Bruce Campbell's there. Matt Cordell is fired into the water in his truck.
Yeah, he gets like impaled and then falls into the river, and then somehow miraculously is not in the river anymore, even though they've like drained it out.
Oh no, we saw his at the end. We see his hand grab one of the dock posts.
Yeah, but like, goddamn, he managed to get past cops and everything. Like, he's a stealthy mofo.
That's the thing. Just like all slashers, yeah. When they're not in their killing mode, like the big slashers, like your Jasons and your
when they're not being looked at, they're invisible.
When they're not being looked, just like slow Romero zombies. When you can't see them, they are the stealthiest thing.
Yeah, when none of the main characters can see them, they are invisible.
Yes.
They just gain invisibility, like Jason Voorhees. So,
or Scissor Man,
yeah,
who has the warp ability.
Mm-hmm. So,
I wish they made a movie of that.
Yeah.
Clock Tower.
Yeah, that would be cool. So,
we'd be covering it.
So, after this, like, ending finishes, basically, like, the ending of the first one finishes up, it shows a 24-hour convenience store.
Yes.
And, Nelson's dad's behind the counter.
Yep.
It seriously does look like Nelson's dad, though. Anyways, he's behind the counter, he's, like, counting up the money or something, he's running the store. Mm. Some guy goes in, basically is just, like, looking really, really shady.
Very, very shifty.
Very shifty.
A coat is all greasy.
Shady as hell, this guy. And you know he's gonna rob the place. Mm. Pulls out a shotgun.
Sawn off.
And, whips it out and points it at the guy and is basically, telling this guy, I think his name is Julio. Yeah, well, it is Julio's bodega. So he's telling Julio, yo, give me all the money.
Give me a lottery ticket.
No, he's like, give me all the money. And he's like, oh, we don't have any money, though. We got, like, $20 in the register. Okay. He's like, okay, then let's start opening up lotto tickets, yeah? So, like, they start opening up lottery tickets. And he won,
how much? I think it was $5,000.
Yeah, $5,000.
He wins $5,000. You won $5,000.
Yay! And then Maniac Cop walks in.
Well, we're not supposed to know it's a Maniac Cop yet. An 8-foot-tall cop.
We know it's Manic Pushy.
Okay,
look. Oh, yeah, I call this movie Manic Pushy, by the way.
The thing is, the movie seems to think we're idiots. That's the problem.
That's all horror movies, though. Like, you never think it's Jason Voorhees.
It's a while.
And then, oh my god!
This is a while later from the first movie, because the first movie was around St. Patrick's Day. Mm-hmm. This, I'm guessing, is around Christmas.
Because Christmas lights are up. And there's like snow on the ground and stuff.
Not much snow on the ground. New York.
And in like the strip club scene and everything, like they have I think like tinsel and stuff on the poles.
We say there's not much snow because that's New York. We live in Canada.
Yeah.
Where the winters are harsh.
Yes. It's like, oh, you think that's a lot of snow? Come over here, guys.
In the States,
my sister actually went to New York once, and she was driving down the highway, and everybody was going, like, maybe, like, 5 to 10 miles an hour on the highway, and, like, there was, like, maybe, like, 2 inches of snow on the ground, and she's just zigzagging past them at, like, 50.
This is how it goes. In the States...
Yeah.
It starts being winter when it gets cold and starts to snow.
Yeah.
In Canada, it becomes winter when vast sections of road are closed down because it's all snow.
Yeah.
In Russia, winter starts when the first person dies of hypothermia.
Yes. Okay. So yeah, back to the movie basically. Maniac Cop walks in. Grabs the shotgun basically out of this guy's hands, just shoots Julio straight up, and I screamed, "Oh no, Nelson's dead!"
and then the criminal's like, no, please don't hit." Just thrust the gun into his hands and leaves out the back, and then he runs out while the other cops are coming because
the silent alarm went off.
Yeah.
So obviously
there's a dead guy with a shotgun blast, a smoking gun in his hand.
Yep.
Like, it wasn't me. It was
the cop. It was a cop.
And then he gets riddled with bullets.
It's like, you'll never believe me, but it was a cop. You're right. I don't believe.
That's a different guy.
Yeah, I know. That was still like, oh my god, that line. It wasn't me. It was a cop. You're right. I don't believe you. Get the fuck out of here. Oh man. So, it shows Bruce and Teresa. Bruce Campbell and Teresa. Mallory.
Groovy.
They're
going through counseling.
Yeah, they're talking to a shrink.
Well, they're being assigned the shrink right now. But they're talking, just like, Peter's like, so you don't believe us? No, of course I don't believe you. Your story's insane.
Yeah.
It's like, it was this dead police officer who was 8 feet tall and bulletproof who came back to life and started killing. Would you believe that?
You're right, I don't believe you. Get the fuck out of here.
I mean, that's always the thing that I kind of hesitate about in slasher movies.
Yeah.
You're supposed to think, oh, why aren't they believing them? But example, Nightmare on Elm Street.
Mm-hmm.
Your normal person, if you tell them, hey, this burned man with claws and a fedora is coming into our dreams and making us die for real, that's a ridiculous story.
Yeah.
And you shouldn't expect someone to believe you.
Yeah. Well, speaking of fedoras, we end up seeing Detective McKinley.
Ah, yes.
And who I call Detective Noir.
Yeah, he is film noir.
He is the definition of film noir.
He looks a bit like the Shadow without the mask.
He really does. He looks really imposing in this movie, honestly. I don't know who plays him.
He has very pockmarked skin, though.
Yeah, but he's freaking intimidating as hell. I love this guy. The way that he plays a cop is good.
Therese and Campbell.
Yeah.
Get assigned to a shrink who is played by Claudia Christian, okay, who you may know from...
She's from America 3000.
No, that's...
No, wait, which one's she from again?
Mallory's from America 3000.
Yeah, yeah.
Claudia Christian plays Lieutenant Commander Susan Ivanova on Babylon 5.
Oh, yeah, okay. She's I've watched a lot of Babylon 5.
I have, and she's not really good in this movie compared to how she is in Babylon. It's like, watching it, I'm just thinking, but you're a good actress. Why are you bad at this?
She probably plays a lot more of a detailed character in Babylon 5 than she does in freaking Maniac Cop, where she plays the
Maniac
shrink.
Cop.
But, yeah, that shows, Detective McKinley, Detective Noir, basically just straight up shooting a guy in an alleyway in classic noir fashion.
It is interesting just how much of this movie is reused scenes from the first one.
I know, it's great.
It's like the first...
They straight up use, the flashback scene again.
7 minutes, yeah. The flashback scene are just the same thing again.
Yeah, by the way, every time I see that flashback scene, man, that cut to his cheek, that one last, cut to his cheek when he's dead, my God, it gets me every time. It's just like... Ugh.
Maniac Cop has an interesting soundtrack as well. I mean, it's not... It's hardly on the level of Halloween.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
And it's not... it's kind of on the same level, a bit creepier than Friday the 13th.
Yeah, well, it's supposed to be horror action, so...
But lower than Nightmare.
Yeah. Well, it's supposed to be, a horror action, as where Nightmare on Elm Street's, straight horror. Horror.
Okay,
comedy.
It devolves into just slapstick
comedy. Not as bad as it does, though.
Once you get to the sixth one,
uh-huh.
He's riding around on a broomstick dressed as a witch. That is silly.
Yes.
He kills someone with a power glove. And you know it's a dream because the power glove's working.
I love the power glove.
It's
so bad.
You have no idea.
So McKinley goes to see the shrink.
Yeah, Susan,
and he's like, I felt no remorse for shooting that man.
Well, and so, I killed him. He was a criminal.
Yeah,
it's looking at him, especially some of the monologues he has.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the Punisher movie when he was actually on the force?
It very much was
he's the
that.
Punisher. He's the Punisher when he was on the force in this movie.
Punisher Noir. Oh my God, that needs to be a thing. Punisher Noir.
Punisher Noir is a thing.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It's really not that good.
Okay.
Well. I mean, because the thing is, the Punisher is already noir.
Yeah, basically.
He just wears a skull mask. Yeah. Looks kind of like a skinny crossbones.
That's actually kind of a little bit worse than Punisher 2099.
Okay, it's not that bad.
I kind of like the fact that he, hacks the computer systems to give him that little stupid skull on his, the pixelated skull on his face. it's kind of a little bit better than wearing a mask. It makes me
this is the thing.
What?
The Punisher is still called Frank Castle with Punisher Noir.
Yeah.
In Punisher 2099, he's called Jack Gallows, which sounds stupid.
I don't know, it's a pretty intimidating name, but I still like Frank
Castle.
It's
an intimidating name if you're a wrestler and you took it and you gave yourself that name, but to be born with
Gallows.
That name is a little insane.
My name is Gallows.
It's it's not really your choice to be a vigilante at this point, it's your
you're
destiny.
You're living your destiny.
Example, Dr. Doom.
Mm-hmm.
His last name is actually Doom. He it doesn't have another career path than supervillains.
What else am I gonna do? So, after this, it shows the death of Bruce Campbell.
Yeah.
By the hands of the Maniac.
That's the worst thing in this movie.
Yeah, honestly,
you don't kill off Bruce Campbell.
Yeah, that was the worst part because like they should have kept him. Like
Bruce Campbell,
he was the best part of the first one. He was just
Him and Robert Zadar.
Yeah,
because Robert Zadar is really cool in this.
Robert Zadar,
I love the. I've always loved the slap throw.
Yeah,
you know when he just the hands just down and throw slap grab.
he becomes like a Lou Ferrigno's Hulk. He's just like Corval smash.
I would like to see the three 80s cops face off.
Oh yeah,
Maniac Cop versus Samurai Cop versus RoboCop. I would love to watch.
That'd be the best versus Judge Dredd.
No, his name doesn't end in cop.
I know.
Also, you get problems there because he's his own cop.
Oh, can they also fight Werewolf Cop and Demon Cop?
Demon Cop doesn't exist.
Demon Cop doesn't exist?
There are no traces of that film left.
Really?
No, all that's left is the stills I found.
That's strange.
That's all that's left of that movie.
That's so strange. Man, I wanna know more about that. Okay, so, Bruce Campbell's at, like, a newsstand, and he's, like, buying newspaper from a
blind black man.
Yeah, he's actually in the newspaper, and he's like, oh, I want to see how I look.
He's buying newspapers from Jamal, because he's back.
Jamal was
back from gold school.
Yeah, he went blind after he went to ghoul school, and then subsequently went.
No, he went blind because of something the aliens did to him after the alien invaders.
Yeah, he just like he got probed like in his eyes,
and was somehow and obviously was sent back in time to end up in 1990 after he left the year 2000.
He's seen too much. Jamal's seen too much. So
are we just can we just agree that every single black person we see in any movie we see is Jamal at various stages through his time traveling existence?
That'd be too much. We need to like have some sort of like timeline for it.
The timeline of Jamal. Can we cut this guy out of the Jamal timeline because it requires time travel?
It also requires him like switching mediums from cartoon to live action.
Yes, that's a good point.
And aging about like 40 years.
I just realized. Of the animated Scooby Doo films we took a look at, of the good ones, Alien Invaders is the only film to have people that aren't white.
Yeah,
everyone in Witch's Ghost and Zombie Island were white.
Strange, right?
There were no black people in New Orleans.
It's so fucked up. That's so crazy. Oh, man. It's like, nope, no black people at all in this New Orleans movie. Nope. None at all. Not one
of them. But getting back to this movie.
Because almost all of them were evil.
Who?
Well, like, all of the people that were living there, like, the three main people that were living there were evil. Anyways. True. Spoilers.
spoilers. It was like months ago.
Yeah, spoilers in Maniac Cop 2.
For a movie that we reviewed months ago.
Yeah, sorry kids, your Scooby-Doo spoilers are in your Maniac Cop 2. You're getting my Scooby-Doo in my Maniac Cop 2. Scooby-Doo in the Maniac Cop.
I would like to see Scooby gang go up against all the classic horror slashers.
That would be so.
They did Friday the 13th in Robot Chicken.
I want to see
the rest of it. I want to see them go up against Freddy. I want to see them go up against Michael Myers.
I thought they did a bunch more in Robot Chicken. Anyways, it could be just like wishful thinking.
Anyway, back to the film.
Yeah. Bruce Campbell gets stabbed straight up by the Maniac Cop. It just shows like the Maniac Cop like walking down the street, like
doing the cool baton spinning.
Spinning his baton like back.
This is one they had to open up in the trailer with the cool synth music.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. He does like really good work, and I'm not sure if it's like a stunt double or something that does like
Robert Zadar. Can do all this stuff. You haven't seen Samurai Cop. He does all the samurai tricks.
No, I've seen Samurai Cop.
Yeah, that's all him.
Okay, cool. Nice. Good to know that.
It's also, unfortunately for Robert Zadar, it's him who gets set on fire near the end of the movie.
My god, when he gets set on fire and just throwing people, I was like, oh man.
I'm going to run out and stab the man who's on fire. That's a good idea.
Yeah, I was reminded heavily of our Punisher playthrough.
Yes.
In the prison. The last level with all of the fires.
Punisher versus Maniac Cop.
That would be the best.
Okay. We gotta stop.
Last thing about that. I wonder how Frank Castle would react after he unloads machine guns into this guy and nothing happens.
Bullets are like mosquitoes to the Maniac Cop.
So I'm just imagine, you know those memes of people just in the bar, like head holding their head, screaming kind of thing. Does that with the guy? I shot him. I like all of my guns, even the bazookas. He's still not dead. What do I do?
Pray.
Ash could take him out.
Groovy.
Or he'll get his neck ripped open like in this movie.
He just comes up behind him, like shoves his knife directly through his neck.
Yeah.
Through the back. In front of this blind guy, basically kicking him in blood.
So they're interrogating Mallory about this.
Yeah.
But it's not Mallory's fault.
Mm-hmm.
But they know it isn't.
They're blaming her, though.
Yeah, but they know it's not actually her.
Yeah.
They're just trying to keep her on her toes a bit.
Yeah, they're basically telling her, like, oh, okay, you know what, you're the only one that's, like, the only logical explanation for this. Detective, is you guys were working together, like, orchestrating this whole Maniac Cop thing.
Detective Castle, he's, two things. One, he really cannot stand psychologists, which mm-hmm. is why he has the friction with Ivanova.
Mm-hmm.
And just you know this thing you're doing, you're wasting time when you should be out finding the actual killer? You guys are idiots?
Yeah.
Cause he's a hard boiled cop on the edge. He's a cliche.
Yeah, and he kind of like he doesn't believe in like things that are like too good to be true or like too weird like to be like true. He's actually pretty much believes in this sort of thing that is happening. He's like, there is a maniac cop going around. There is someone dressed as a cop killing people, and apparently
we get another interesting kill where there's this rich guy.
Oh yeah, the guy,
the 90s rich guy whose car's being towed.
Yeah, he's like arguing with this cop who's gonna tow his car.
And it gets to the point, he starts with trying to bribe him.
Yeah.
Then he starts insulting him. Like, you know, I'd come by really early tomorrow morning. A lot of cars get stripped down in our lot.
Just straight up admitting he's crooked as fuck.
No, he's not admitting that. He's like, dude, you're being an asshole to me, so I'm gonna
have your car stripped down.
I'm gonna have your car stripped because you're...
But that's illegal. It's fucking illegal. He's just straight up admitting.
And then the guy gets killed by the maniac cop.
Yeah, he just grabs, like, the maniac cop just walks up, grabs the cop, hangs him onto the hook on the truck, and just drives him around.
Just drives off, and the guy's like, tears up his ticket. Wow, he's just, like,
hanging off the end like he's fuzzy dice. Like a pair of fuzzy dice on the back of his car.
So the other guy's like, oh, I don't have a ticket. Then he gets arrested for killing him.
Yup.
And then...
it wasn't me, it was the cop.
You're not gonna... You won't believe me if I tell you. Try me. It was a cop. A big, great big cop. You know what? You're right. I don't believe you. Get in there.
Fucking... Get the fuck out of here. So, yeah, Teresa gets marked, actually, after this. She's like, they're basically like, okay, they killed Bruce, now they're gonna come after her.
She's going to be going on this, talk show to talk about it.
Yeah, and
she's so they basically get in a cab to go to the TV studio.
Yeah.
With Ivanova.
Mm-hmm.
And then the air gets taken out of the tires.
Yeah, they get in, like, they get into a cab.
Teresa Mallory, they end up at a hardware store. She takes a chainsaw and tries to fight the maniac.
Yeah, they crash through the... Don't they, like, crash into it after, like, this big car chase? Yeah, so they, like, crashed into it.
She fights Matt Cordell. The chainsaw. He kills her.
Yep.
Then he locks he weights down the gas.
Yeah, he basically has her ghost riding this car, basically.
Yeah, like hang up to it.
But she manages to get back into the car.
She manages to go to the... she gets injured in the car because she breaks her arm.
She gets in there, but, like... No, she breaks both of her wrists.
Because I remember her arm's in a sling later.
One of her arm breaks, but like both of her wrists are broken, I think. The Maniac Cop has like the weird the handcuffs that have like serrated edges on the inside, so they cut the wrists when they're on there. So like her.
So she gives a talk show thing, talks about Matt Cordell.
Yeah.
Then we meet another villain for the movie, a bearded guy who don't know his name, but he looks a bit like a short-haired Charles Manson.
I just called him the second killer. He had a name. I don't remember exactly what his name was.
He's kind of stalking the strip joint.
Yeah, he's just basically like a stripper killer.
He
goes around killing strippers, and
he
has like a little collection.
He breaks into the room of one.
He's a fucking psycho.
He breaks into the room of one of them, mm-hmm. tries to kill her, but then runs into Matt Cordell, mm-hmm. and then just kind of follows him.
Yeah. Oh man.
And takes him to his house, and then they make they're planning to go to the prison.
Yep. I think he's not as crazy. The second killer, honestly, not as crazy as Leland Palmer in Twin Peaks. What do you think, Leland Palmer or him?
To be fair, Leland Palmer was possessed by a dark being from the Black Lodge.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. I'll take that as a yes. I'm gonna go with Leland.
Or as crazy as Mr. Mullet Ponytail.
Oh, yeah, Leo Johnson.
Yeah.
Leo Johnson's just, like, mentally fucked. Like, especially in season two, he is just, like, straight up mentally, like, fucked up.
Or as crazy as the,
he's coming back from basically being, like, paraplegic.
Yep.
So.
Or as crazy as, Coffee Man's Moriarty.
Yep.
I can't remember Coffee Man's name. He's the best character. The main character.
Yeah.
That's not important, though, right now.
Yeah. Okay. So, the killer basically, like, the second killer breaks into the stripper's house. What's her name again? I wrote her name. Cheryl. Yeah, so, like, he attacks Cheryl, and he's like, I'm a finish you nice and fat, nice and slow. It'll be over in a minute. And he, like, starts to choke her. And then suddenly the Maniac Cop busts through
the door. A wild Maniac Cop appears.
He just punches the door.
And rescues him.
Yeah. They just like leave out the window. And after the Maniac Cop throws Cheryl across the wall.
Then they're getting ready for something. Cheryl's fine, by the way.
Yeah.
Well, physically.
Physically, she's okay. Aside from the fact that she just was attacked by a psychopath. Well, two psychopaths, technically. Well,
technically one psychopath and a golem.
So... That's essentially what the Maniac Cop is. He's a fucking golem. It's the golem is.
So that they go off. We have the talk show.
Yep.
She almost gets fired over this.
Yep.
She's in the shooting range.
When they're going up to the roof, I just wanted to like point out just that tiny little like tidbit that I found just hilarious as I was watching the movie.
Sure.
As they're both going up to the roof, the Maniac Cop and the killer, the second killer guy, they're going up to the roof, and if you look closely as they're climbing up the ladder on like the building like across from them, there's just a guy in the window just dancing. Okay. I found it hilarious. I don't know why. It was just like came out of nowhere. Just this guy's just dancing in the window.
Whole... dance sequences in horror things. Yeah. Except, have you played Phantasmagoria 2?
Yeah.
You know when he first goes to the borderline, just those three guys just dancing. Yeah. Just dancing. I was like,
what? As they're going out. Like, just...
What?
The barbershop quartet.
And then we have the house just like boom, and they're just boom, 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 boom. It's like, okay, that happened.
This is amazing.
Discount West Side Story.
Yep. So yeah. Oh yeah, and they start talking about their big knives.
Yeah.
They're just like, oh, I've got this. Have you ever seen anything so just brutal in your entire
life? And he draws his little sword, his freaking
the baton knife.
Just, you got a big one too.
It's honestly, I found the baton knife is the sickest.
I found the second psychopath kind of annoying.
Oh, you really
more
is.
Than anything.
He really is. Like, he's not an interesting character at all. He's kind of boring. He has some funny parts, though. Like, he just has, like, some funny little things that he says sometimes.
I mean, he looks like he somehow stumbled out of Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah.
Like, you know the first of the psychos they meet in that movie?
Yeah.
It's like him somehow wound up in a better movie.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, and as they're talking about their knives and stuff, like, it shows the flashback again.
Again,
man, that one cut, like, across his cheek,
yeah.
Just every time, it's just so disgusting, and, like, it shows, obviously, like, Cordell, when he's alive, just, like, throwing people,
he's
the Hulk.
He is very strong.
He's Lou Ferrigno, essentially. He's like
he
Lou
is the Russian
Hulk. Yeah, he's the Russian. If they didn't have, like, Kevin Nash playing the Russian,
yeah,
yes. And be perfect.
Though, that's one thing I will say about the Punisher game that I didn't like. One of the changes it made that I really didn't like.
Mm-hmm.
Don't make the Russian talk. The Russian was better when it was when it was silent and more grunty. And it didn't give us stuff like, hello, big boy. Bullets are like mosquitoes to the Russian.
It's clobbering time. Favorite saying no thing.
Rockman of Fantastic Four. Big superhero in Russia.
Oh, yeah. The fact that there's just this guy going around with, like, cold hands, like,
oh,
ice cold hands.
That the monologue from the Black Newsstand, because he gets interviewed by Ivanova. That's one
yeah,
of the
I
best,
wanted to mention
best
that.
Lines in the film.
Honestly, like, just the passion this guy has. Like, this guy's been, like, this guy was,
monologue
like,
written down?
I remember it, though.
Okay.
I remember it. I've watched it enough times to... So, yeah.
He was in World War II trenches.
Yeah, he was in the trenches. And he basically, like, his entire trench got, like, just straight up massacred. He's the only one alive, like, mustard gas. And
I think it was a grenade.
Mustard grenade or like,
some kind
was,
of bomb.
Yeah.
Blinded him,
it
killed
blinded,
everyone else.
Yeah, it blinded him, it killed everybody else in there. I'm pretty sure it was mustard gas, though. Anyways, so everybody around him is dead.
So
he had to hide under the dead bodies to,
because he had to bury
himself.
Them.
Yeah, exactly. So, like, he had to, like, cover himself with the dead.
To stay
and,
warm.
Like, he just remembered the coldness of the bodies.
I'd never feel anything like that again. At night they froze.
Yeah.
I never thought I'd feel anything like that again.
Yeah, and then he
until
put
him.
His hands on me.
Until I felt his hands. Cold,
cold, dead hands.
Dead flesh.
Yeah.
Like, whoa. Interesting to give the monologue to a guy who barely gets a name.
Yeah. But honestly, he's one of the better characters in this.
He
he's very
and
interesting.
Lieutenant Castle are the best characters.
Yeah, that's a flashback I wish I could have seen. That would have been crazy.
Creepy.
It would have been horrifying. Yeah, that's horror right there. That is like straight up the actual, like, that is real life horror right there.
I mean, I would like to see someone do a horror movie set like in the trenches of World War I, in World War II, or in Vietnam or something.
Yeah.
Like a horror movie, some kind of supernatural thing amidst that.
Oh, like set in like a concentration camp or something?
Ooh, that would be interesting.
That would be insane. Oh my god, that would be cool. Okay, we should stop like saying all of our good ideas.
Yeah, but it's just there's not much in this movie. It's
yeah. Well, there's quite a bit still.
They catch second the second
yeah they
killer.
They catch the stripper
they
killer.
Lock him up and he starts singing.
Oh
a
yeah!
Lot, everyone's like, look, I'm being sent to death row tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And presently, the idea of going in the chair is looking a lot better just to get away from your damn singing.
I like to point out that the sign in the back during like the like if you look over the sink.
Yeah.
The sign over the sink and in the little holding cell that they're all in.
Yeah.
It says, "Do not use this as a toilet." It's basically just saying, "Yo, don't piss in the sink, please."
So
you fucking assholes.
Maniac cop barge. They're at a bunch of cops at the shooting range.
The noir one shows up
yeah.
to like intimidate the fuck out of him.
Maniac. So a bunch of cops are at the shooting range. Maniac cops with the a bunch of cops at the shooting range.
Yeah.
And then they start getting shot one by one in the head, and the maniac cop just like.
Yeah, that range scene
just
was pretty cool. That came out of nowhere. I was like, wow. And this is after,
because they're in prison at the police station. Yeah. So he's going through, he grabs a machine gun. Mm-hmm. Not a big one, like a little, you know,
it's an automatic.
It's the heavy SMG from the Punisher game.
Basically.
The pistol, that big thing you have, but that counts as a pistol that you have.
Kind of a little bit. It's like top loaded though.
All I have to say about the about him,
it's the gun basically. I think it was in MGS3. Also, yes. I think the big boss had it.
All I have to say about this about Matt Cordell with this new gun is now I have a machine gun. And basically, he goes through shooting up the police station. He's throwing people through. I think he throws a guy through 10 windows.
Yeah. Oh my god, if I had a dollar for every guy that gets thrown in this movie, in like this series of movies, shit, man.
So he kills everyone in the police station. However, yeah. I have a thing with counting up body counts, if I ever count up body counts for slashers. Mm-hmm. I don't count the ones with just in big groups killing people.
Yeah.
Example, Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2. Mm-hmm. You know when he's at the pool party and he's just running around stabbing people?
Yep.
None of those count. That's one thing I have to say bad about Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2. Aside from the plot makes absolutely no sense.
Mm-hmm.
He only has 2 kills. And they're both him stabbing guys.
Yeah.
Nothing cool in that one. Like the puppets from Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3.
Mm-hmm. So he just straight up rampages through this.
He rescues saves the killer guy.
The
killer and the other black guy.
Mm-hmm. Which, once the noir guy, like, leaves, he ends up going to the killer's apartment and seeing that he has, like, the big shrine of, like, all of the dead, the dead strippers. And he's just like, I think we have a killer here. I'm just like, no fucking shit.
So they go to Sing Sing. They kidnap Susan Ivanova and go to Sing Sing.
Yeah, they're on the way to Sing Sing because they want to break out
everyone.
Yeah,
but Matt Gordell's got different plans.
Yeah, he wants to get revenge on the guys.
He's going to kill every single prisoner in Sing. Basically,
well, no, he didn't. He didn't actually kill all of them. He let some of them go. Mostly killing the ones that killed him.
All I have to say is he's going to. They're going to storm in, free the inmates, and escape the confusion. What are you gonna do?
I'm gonna go in,
kill all the inmates, and escape the confusion.
I'm gonna kill all the inmates, escape the confusion. Fucking Cordell.
This would make a good Punisher comic.
It reminds me even more though because of the fact that like if you're playing the Punisher game like an idiot and you're running through the fire, you're straight up on fire during those.
So you
cuts.
Mean how I play it. Which worked well enough because
and
we
the way
won.
I play it too, especially in slaughter mode. Yes. I played that whole part in slaughter mode essentially. Like I was just running around in slaughter mode on fire. Just like
too bad this
people.
Movie doesn't have a half hour long boring boss fight against a flying guy that you can't fight in any fun way.
Corville's weak and he's gonna die.
Except no, he's not at all. Because he's still not dead.
I know.
He gets set on fire. We see.
Well, technically he is weak and he does die.
We see his face.
Because he gets buried.
We see his new face. Yeah. His nose is off. He's all skeletally.
He looks fucked up.
He looks cool.
He looks like he looks like Red Skull.
It looks more like Jason. Takes Manhattan Jason.
Oh, yeah. Well, like, yeah, you look really fucked up in that.
Because Red Skull is at least symmetrical,
mm.
And it's he has a much thinner face.
Yeah, but still, like, Cordell, like, has no nose.
Cordell.
Cordell, yeah,
Cordell.
Cordell.
Cordell. Cordell. I am my Cordell.
I am my Cordell. So, but yeah, Cordell, like, has no nose and he must sneeze.
He has a great soft jelly thing.
Benny!
Gorister!
Okay.
Mindak!
So, there's this big bus chase, and,
There's that's the quickest way to make something not sound intimidating anymore. Yeah. Car chase, cool. Bus chase. What?
Well, it does have the second killer guy, like, basically going around screaming, bumper cars!
He gets killed, black guy gets killed, all the criminals get killed, yeah. He's on fire, they bury him, mm-hmm. His hand bursts out of the coffin, we're gonna have a sequel. Mm-hmm. And, yeah.
Yeah, that's essentially the long and short of it, guys.
Susan Novotny survives.
And at the end, it does the two dead boys thing. It does, yes. Like, the whole, like, what's
two the dead goes? Two dead boys got up to...
One morning in the middle of the night, I think, two dead boys came up to fight.
They fought the other, drew their nines, and shot each other.
Drew their knives and shot each other.
That doesn't make sense.
Yeah, exactly. That's the whole point of it. Because two dead boys got up to fight.
Drew their knives and shot each other. Something about the death as a cop.
The death cop came and killed the two dead boys.
It
was also in The Crow 2, which I was also watching this weekend.
Oh, that's an awful movie.
I watched all of
Let's
the...
just say it's
No,
not...
I watched three of the four Crow movies, which we need to do one year for Halloween.
I just have to say about that rhyme, it's...
Yeah.
It's not 1-2 Freddy's Coming. It's nowhere near 1-2. Yeah.
Well, it's fitting though because it's a dead cop. So
3-4 then lock your door. 5-6 grab your crucifix. 7-8 better stay up late. 9-10 I'm back again. Commercial for the third one.
Yeah.
Because there's the house and then hit the Freddy Claw burst out of it.
Cool.
I'm your boyfriend now, Nancy.
And I think
and then the Maniac Cop.
That would be an interesting thing to do one day.
Mm-hmm.
A retrospective of Nightmare on Elm Street.
That'd be pretty cool.
Rise and fall of the American Boogeyman.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to mention this, honestly. They could have completely avoided the fact that they got to Sing Sing.
Mm.
If the cops would have straight up just called Sing Sing and told them not to let the bus
in. Hey, we got a giant cop coming.
Yeah.
If you see a bus with like an 8-foot-tall cop inside, don't let them in.
If you see the next bus, just stop all the buses before they come in.
Yeah.
Just don't. Just check them all.
Until further notice.
Stop them. Yeah. But no, the guy with the AK is like, let them in.
I'd say it more like this. Stop them all. Do not approach.
Mm-hmm. It's like, just stop the bus. Don't search it. Don't go inside at all. Don't let them in. Just stop. If anything, open fire. Heavily. It's not gonna do anything. Well, no, it'll do a little bit. It'll kill the killer guy.
Get a grenade launcher. Shoot the bus. So, what do you give this movie?
Oh man, that's a tough call. That's a tough one. I'm gonna give it 3 dead Bruce Campbells out of a total of
Dead by Dawn, Dead by Dawn.
I'm gonna give it 3 dead Bruce Campbells out of a total of 9 stripper poles with tinsel on them.
I'm going to give it 2 knife batons.
Just 2 knife batons?
Just 2 knife batons. Out of having a machine gun. Oh. 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 not my favorite.
Yeah. It's okay. It was alright. Honestly, I still had fun with this movie, though. It was still good. I liked it.
I mean, once you watch enough slasher films, it just get...
Once you watch enough campy slasher films.
But the thing is with this one, it's a campy slasher film, but it does nothing interesting.
It does some stuff interesting.
It doesn't do enough.
It doesn't do enough to interesting.
It doesn't do enough to compete with the likes of Friday the 13th.
And even the first one, I find better.
Just
because like it was interesting, it was fresh.
The problem is in this, there was too much of Matt Cordell gunplay.
That.
Because...
Well, in the first one, he didn't use his gun like at all.
He used it. He one-handed a shotgun.
Yeah,
which was awesome.
He one-handed a shotgun. But
I mean, he had the gun on, mm-hmm. but that's just it's his cop uniform.
Yeah.
It's
Solo.
I don't like it when a slasher uses a gun. It's not...
You want up close and personal.
Well, that's what slashers do.
I want to see the Maniac Cop. I want to see Cordell be in the new Mortal Kombat.
With the others?
Yeah.
He's already in a fighting game.
He is?
Yeah.
Which one?
You know which one. I looked at it over Halloween.
Oh, God.
Terror Drone, remember?
Really? Oh, man. Cool.
So, I've been Merrick D'Amato.
And I've been Gio, guys.
Ciao.
Later.
See you next week.
Peace.